So I wasn't really paying attention to where I was going, but it looks like I'm heading towards Manhattan. This is the Lorimer Street Station. So on the L and the M and the J line, I believe. So further down this way, I actually should reach Manhattan. I don't know. Maybe during the course of my 8-hour walk, I'll reach Manhattan. And maybe my goal then, I guess, would be to reach Central Park, if that's possible to do. New York City, size-wise, is pretty small. I just wanted to come over here and check out this building. This building is interesting. It looks kind of... Whoa. Sorry about that. It looks kind of out of place compared to the rest of the building. I mean, look at this one. It has a fence over the top. It's a brick wall there. It's like an apartment complex over here on Walton Street. And I like how the street name is bent. A humongous complex over there. So definitely want to check this building out. Seal of the city of the New York. Interesting. This is a school. This is a pretty humongous school. So this is hour 2 right now. It's like 10 o'clock. It's like 10:20, I think. So I've pretty much walked for about an hour now. But yeah, I haven't listened to any podcasts because I was busy too. Too busy recording. Too busy trying to get on Twitter. But it's definitely been an interesting experience. I'm feeling the burn right now. It's definitely a hot day. So definitely been a hot day. Probably a little bit later down the road, I think I'm going to get a good gulp of water that I packed and just kind of hydrate myself. I'm sweating a little bit. So it just goes to show you that this definitely, this dog walking position is definitely going to be a physically laborious work, which I expected. I mean, it's not such a surprise. But yeah, it's like spring weather, and it still feels pretty hot. So definitely summer is going to be super hot. Ooh, nice playground. Check that out. I'm gonna see a playground. I love just checking out like places like these, and the school itself has a basketball court, tennis court. There's a guy right there. Playing basketball. Yeah. No one's playing here though. And they got baby seats for swings. Right? I hate those swings actually. But they are safe. They are safe for kids. But not really playable for anyone else other than little babies. So, this part of the... I don't know, I reached it's a little past the Lorimer Street Station. There's an Arabic building. I'm assuming it's either that or Hindu. I have no idea. But it looks Arabic to me. It has a very, this kind of neighborhood has a very austere feeling to it. I've seen a lot of people walk past me who are like wearing black suits and the hat thingy. So I'm assuming that this is, like, there's a lot of Jewish people here. That's what I'm assuming. So it's a very interesting neighborhood, I think. Oh, I actually passed something that I thought was pretty interesting to me that caught my eye. So I actually want to go back here. So just, I've been walking pretty fast, so I think I can kind of take the time to kind of take back. And see, he has a really interesting way of outreaching about business. Great new service, alterations. I do expert tailoring and alterations. So he left some little contact info here, is alterations, Milka, 718, on a tree. See that? Interesting. Yeah, no, I think I made a mistake in thinking that was like Arabic or Hindi. Definitely, judging just from the neighborhood, I think that's like Hebrew, I think. But it's a very interesting neighborhood, like a lot of trees. Yeah, very fancy looking brownstones. It looks very, let's see, like this feels more, I guess, a little bit more quaint Brooklyn, definitely, than my neighborhood. My neighborhood is mostly Hispanic. This neighborhood is, I'm assuming, just from the look of the place, very Jewish. I think it looks very nice, very uppity. Looks good. So don't really know what to say about that, but really hope to encounter a lot of these like ethnic communities on my walk too. I know Brooklyn is just full of them. there's a lot of subcultures in Brooklyn. I wanted to go, next time I do something like this, I definitely want to hit Bed-Stuy. But right now I'm heading towards Manhattan, so definitely past Bedford-Stuy, Syverson. But this is the Lorimer Street. It looks to be pretty much like a Jewish or Hebrew subculture, I think. Don't know what I'll encounter later. If I was heading towards Queens, I would hit like a Indian subculture or Chinese subcommunity. So far this is very peaceful looking. I don't know where like Little Italy is or something like that, but that's the amazing thing about being in New York City. There's so many diverse kind of cultures, like, and they make it their own country. It seems like, you know, you could really experience like different nations inside the city itself, which I always found interesting. And in a lot of ways, it also tells about how we as humans like to be living and associating with like-minded people. So it almost feels like enclosures. You know, sometimes you walk into a neighborhood and you're just like, I don't feel like I belong here because I'm not what they are. There's definitely a lot of that in New York City. Sometimes it's kind of also disheartening and kind of frustrating in a way, because I used to live in the Bronx, and I would take the 4 or 5 train up to the Bronx from Manhattan because I used to go to NYU, and just seeing the faces change during one subway ride up to the Bronx, it's pretty telling. It's just like, you know, the faces, the people that get off and get on the train change as you go further and further uptown. And I've actually gone really uptown before. I've gone to like 246th Street or something like that, just because I used to work as a security guard way up in the Bronx. And I got off that stop, I looked around the neighborhood, and it's just like, wow, what a difference. There's buildings that have been abandoned for 5 years. There's just people just hanging around the street, not really doing much. It's almost like they're waiting for something to happen, something to lift them up. And there was a school nearby, but it didn't look like anything like a school at all. It looked like a warehouse building. It's just such a humongous difference like that. And of course, pretty much majority of the people there were colored, like people of color. So I don't really know what kind of culture it was, but my neighborhood in the South Bronx, it was mostly Dominican. And then further up, it was mostly Puerto Rican. But of course, Black Dominican, of course, and the Caribbean and the West Indians. And, you know, it's just a very, you get to see a lot of cultural enclosures, I would say, in New York City a lot. I mean, New York City is full of diversity, but at the same time, it is full of self-inflicted segregation, self-chosen segregation. I mean, there's a lot of reason. I mean, there's nothing particularly like wrong about that. It's just what happens. You know, there's so many obstacles in getting acculturated with other cultures or interacting with other cultures. You know, for a lot of the Asian and West Indian cultures, there's a language barrier, and then there's also a culture barrier. So connecting with people of the same culture, the same language, that's hard to get past by. I mean, it's a big challenge also for like the first generation and the second generation children, right? Because they have to learn both cultures at the same time. I mean, I'm an example. I immigrated from Korea when I was 10. And the way I view things and the way I interact with people from other cultures and within my same culture is so completely different from the way my parents interact. Well, my parents are in Tennessee right now, but my 90% of, I don't know, like 99% of the contacts that they have are all their Koreans. Well, my parents are in an interesting situation, though, because my dad's a pastor there, and his congregation is half and half, because it's a very, there's a military base there, and the Korean congregation that he preaches to are mostly women. They're mostly the wives of retired military soldiers or military career men. And then their husbands are, of course, the American GIs who are retired, who are mostly white. So that's an interesting situation, but just goes to show you, like, my dad, he barely knows how to speak English. You know, and he's very good at knowing the grammar. He's good at knowing how to write English, which is a feat in itself. But talk to him in English, we will not understand you, because he will catch like one or two words here and there, but he will not understand you. And him speaking English is sometimes a bit worse as well. My mom's a little better because she worked as a nurse in American hospitals for over 15 years now. She's not working anymore, but she has over 30 years of experience as a nurse under her belt. So that's, her English is definitely a lot better, although her writing skills are, you know, compared to my dad, is pretty horrific. I know, it's a little mean to be so blunt about my parents' English skills, but this is true. When my mom sends me an email, it's full of so many LOL moments. It's just like, wow, did she really write that kind of thing? But, you know, I really, my mom is a very inspiring figure because she's always trying her best. And it's sometimes almost daunting because there's a lot of pressure on me to do well. And I almost always feel like I can't meet the expectations of my parents. So I believe I'm coming across Manhattan. Look at those skyscrapers and the Hudson River, I believe. I am not really great on geographical names, but let's cross the street. Hopefully I don't get hit by a car. Looks good. So that is the picturesque Manhattan. Whenever New York City is pictured in movies or video games or what have you, this is what you see. This is what they represent, except for certain unique artistic films or video games. Like Grand Theft Auto is like the only game to feature like the other parts of New York City, like Bronx and Brooklyn, which I thought was a pretty bold move of them. And I loved experiencing the Bronx and Brooklyn in Grand Theft Auto 4, you know, or the representations of it. It's not really called Brooklyn or Bronx. It's called something else. But I really just want to come here and sightsee this. Let me slow down to a stop. There's a fence over here. I want to come to the pier over here and just kind of take a good view of this. So I think I can get a better view somewhere else probably, but this is a sign that I've really come pretty far in this journey so far. This is hour two. So I walked for about 2 hours and this is where I've come to. Just the New York City right there across this, and there's the bridge. That's another thing, I don't know how I'm gonna cross to New York City. Is there a bridge to take? I'm assuming that's the bridge to take, walking wise. I'm gonna try to walk. If I can't make it, maybe I'll take a subway train or bus. But just to get into the city, after that, I will definitely be walking. I'm hoping to just walk in there, you know, keep walking, because this is after all a walking journey. Towards that way is Manhattan, and I want to get there, but I don't really know how to get across, because right after this block, that's a dead end, and I know this bridge will take me there. How I'm going to get on this bridge is a different question altogether. I'm hoping maybe I walk up this way, maybe there will be like a stair leading up to it, or something like that is what I'm hoping, or some kind of station to get into. Do I have to pay a fare? I have no idea, I've never done this before. I've never walked from Brooklyn into New York, into Manhattan. So this is definitely going to be interesting. I have no idea. I do want to get into Manhattan. I think there's going to be a lot to show. But I'm kind of disappointed that I didn't run into any ethnic enclaves later in the Jewish neighborhood. But yeah, this is definitely the way to go. I want to get in there. Meanwhile, I've been pretty... Listen to like 4 episodes of a podcast so far, and I always listen to them on 2x the speed. So an hour podcast will be for me like 30 minutes, just because I can understand everything that they're saying in that fast pace, and I like to kind of just, you know, take it all in really quickly. But I was listening to the Grassroots Channel podcast. It wasn't actually that great, surprisingly. Like the first, I only had like 5 episodes of them. I'm sure there's more that I can download on iTunes. But yeah, the first episode that I heard was regarding like the growth of the internet, how they did a survey like 5 years before and only had the 30% of the participants had access to internet, but now, 5 years later, it's 56% of the communities that they surveyed have access to internet. So this explosive growth in access to internet, that was interesting. And that was pretty much it, though. Well, they were very short. They didn't really talk about the implications of internet growth like that, which would have been really interesting to delve into and get into. But the episodes after that were, I don't know, I felt really disconnected. Currently, I skipped over to another podcast called the Mental Illness Happy Hour Podcast. What an interesting title to name your podcast. But I've never listened to this podcast before, so I'm starting on episode one. And so far, it's off to a really interesting start. The host, one of the hosts, the female host, starts off talking about her depression and that she had to go through during college years, and how it was actually, she had a nervous breakdown that was spurred on or perhaps instigated, she's not really sure, by her pot use. So she smoked a lot of pot, and she would, after smoking a lot of pot, she would get these kind of nervous breakdown or just feeling so horrible and depressed. And then she stayed sober after three times of that, but then it hit her when she was not high. And she says it felt like I was high, but in a really bad way. So that's, it sounds like a really interesting dive into mental illnesses, starting with the host themselves, what they went through. So far it sounds like a really awesome podcast. I'd have to listen to more of it. The first episode seems to be about an hour long, so it should take me about 30 minutes to get through it, but I'm actually listening to the podcast instead of recording videos constantly like this. But so far, yeah, there's nothing much here to see other than me trying to get up to that bridge, which is where I want to get to. I want to get into Manhattan and kind of really record the whole experience, because I've never recorded Manhattan either, and that's always something I always wanted to do as well. I was just about to start listening to podcasts again until I came across this wall. So, murder is never just. That's interesting, but there is also, like, look, there's another interesting stuff. America is still Christian. This one is repeated. Real Jews love Jesus, right? You see it here, but then if I go over here also, here. Real Jews love Jesus with the fish for men. God is true love. Jesus died for Jews, too. Wow. So, just got to show you, that's New York City. That's why I love the city. Okay, so I walked from there, and there's this big old building here. Good old statue. And this is what I've been looking forward to. Away on to the bridge. On to Manhattan we go. So, just on Manhattan, continuing to listen to Mental Illness Happy Hour podcast. It's getting really good. It's really talking about the physical manifestations of depression and how, it's just a really good podcast so far starting out. It's really great. But anyway, walking across Manhattan, I know these fences are here for like to prevent people trying to commit suicide, but it's really blocking my view of the city. That's a little disappointing. Another disappointing thing is that my phone has now about 20% battery life left. Wow, recording video footage really, really drains the battery life out of this thing. So that's very disappointing. I hope the phone doesn't run out of battery by the time like I want to show up really cool stuff. But let me just take a stop right here and just take a moment to just view all this, take this all in. Over there is Brooklyn. And over there, of course, is Manhattan. It's quite a scene. So I hit Manhattan. Chinatown is right near the bottom of Manhattan. So that's where I find myself. And I've come across this food fair that's going on, which is always great. There's always, like, somewhere in New York City, there's at least several of these things going on, like, every weekend. And it's just kind of great to see that these things kind of happen. Of course, most of the stuff here I probably cannot purchase just because I'm vegan. But it is always nice to see how, you know, local people are just come out and do their kind of selling and marketing this way. I want to cross the street so I can record bad thing right now is that my phone is at a battery life of less than 10%. So I hope it doesn't die like too quickly. It's kind of disappointing because I think at this pace, I'm going to hit Central Park. And I think at this pace, I might even hit Harlem. And hopefully if I walk fast enough, even to the Bronx. Judging by the fact that I have less than 10% of battery life on this phone, probably not going to be able to record that, other than me being able to say something about it afterwards when I get home. Cool. Getting a massage therapist. Yeah, so let's just have a look-see. Really interesting. Little carnival games. Set up with the Xbox 360. Wow. This might be one of the biggest ones I've ever, like, been in inside New York City. It's pretty awesome. Italian sausage. There was a plate of peppers, which I would have been able to eat. I'm just gonna cross the street really quickly. I feel like a journalist just walking here with my phone held up high. Yeah, definitely a really good place to set up shops. Look, it goes down like several blocks that way. Pretty awesome. And the restaurants nearby have a really homely feel to them too. A lot of Italian restaurants here, so apparently Chinatown and Little Italy kind of blend in together. I'm starting to feel the burn during the walk. So this is, right now it's about 12:30, I think. So this is, I have so far walked about 3 hours and 30 minutes. Haven't taken a break ever. I just was feeling a little thirsty, so I got my water bottle out of my backpack and just drank along the way. So I'm pretty surprised at how quickly I got here to Manhattan. It only took, even after all the wandering around, it only took about 3 hours to get here. Hoping to get to like NYU and then kind of do some recording and personal anecdotes here because I went to there for college.